So this is the University of Ottawa Nonlinear Optics course, October 11th, 2016, and this is lecture 5. So, hello everybody. Bonjour tout le monde. You're supposed to say bonjour. Okay, so I know we started quantum mechanics last time, but I forget exactly what the last equation was that I had on the board. Can someone just show me? Thank you. Okay, so the very last thing we did was to calculate the probability amplitudes, zeroth order, first order, and second order. So this is a quantum mechanical calculation. I didn't even fold the page over, so this is exactly the right page. So let me begin, but let me try to put this at least a little bit into context. So what are we trying to do? So the goal of this calculation is to determine quantum mechanical This may be the world's shortest lecture. Expressions for chi 1, chi 2, and chi 3. Why don't we just stop the filming? I will go get a better marking pen. Last week, we were in the middle of a calculation. The goal was to determine the quantum mechanical expressions for chi 1, chi 2, and chi 3. As a step along the way, we had found the probability amplitudes A, and let me just make sure I have my notation straight now. You change the name of things along the way, that's not good. A L0 of T, A M1 of T, A N2 of T. And the one here means it's the first order correction. Okay, that's just to remind you where we are. I won't copy down everything again. So, and as a first step, let's calculate the linear susceptibility. And the linear susceptibility what we can call chi 1 of omega. And I guess just to put this in more physical terms, we apply a laser field at frequency omega. And we know that this is the ground state. And we know that M is really just a dummy index. There are many, many levels up here, and we will use the label M to specify them. (Clears throat) And we want to know, what is the induced dipole moment? Well, once you know the induced dipole moment, you can then calculate the susceptibility. So the physical quantity is this quantity here. So let's call this P. So this is the dipole moment in the time domain. And what we want to do is to take the quantum mechanical expectation value of that quantity. And according to the rules of quantum mechanics, that means we take the wave function psi, we take the operator for the dipole moment, and we put the wave function again here. So, how do we do this? Let's represent the wave function psi of r and t as psi 0 plus psi 1. Now, the idea of perturbation theory is that there's actually an infinite number of terms here, but we will truncate this after the lowest order correction, because we said we want the linear susceptibility, so we just want the lowest order correction to the wave function of the atom. So we take this and we put it here. And what we find is that this is equal to psi 0 mu psi 1 plus psi 1 mu psi 0. Now, you might think that there is another term, psi 1 mu psi 1, but a moment's thought tells you that this is not something we want to include, because this would be second order. A first order correction taken twice is a second order correction, so we drop this here. So now we just have to plug in to this expression. So this should be in your notes from the last class. So the zeroth order wave function is ug of r. This is the spatially varying part of the wave function. G stands for ground state. E to the minus I E G T over H power. Yes?
So I understand why we dropped the psi 1, psi 1 term.
Yes.
But what about the other psi 0, psi 1 term?
Psi 0, psi 1, psi 1, psi 0.
Oh, that's right.
Okay. Oh, you thought there was an equal sign or something?
No.
We will not bother to challenge you on how you were thinking wrong, right? There's an infinite number of ways to think wrong. Okay, so, and now just to make our lives simpler going ahead in the calculation, let me define omega g to be E g over h bar. Doesn't seem like much, but once you get equations that cover the entire sheet of paper, anything you can do to minimize pen strokes will be useful. And now, again going back to the last lecture, the expression for the first order correction to the wave function is the sum over L of A L 1 of T U L of R e to the minus I omega L T, where A L 1 of T is 1 over H bar sum over P mu L G dot E of omega P over omega L G minus omega P E to the I omega L G minus omega P times T. Okay, so perhaps messy, but very straightforward. Right? We want to calculate this quantity, we want to calculate this quantity. Psi 0 is this, psi 1 is this, where A is given by that. So you put it all together, and what you find is that P1 is equal to 1 over H bar sum over P sum over M mu G M mu M G dot E of omega P E to the minus I omega P T over omega M G minus omega P. That's from the first term. And now the second term is mu M G dot E of omega P complex conjugate mu m g e to the I omega p t divided by omega m g minus omega p. Now, why is there a complex conjugate here? Well, because that comes from the bra vector, not the ket vector. So the bra vector has you take the complex conjugate when you represent this as a real space function. Now, you stare at this and you say to yourself, which term is larger, the first term or the second term? And it's not so clear when you write it this way. So we're going to rewrite it in a way that makes the physical content of this a little more straightforward. So what we're going to do is we're going to let omega p be replaced by minus omega p in the second term. Now, P is a dummy index. We are summing over this. So if you're summing over all values of omega P, both positive and negative, just flipping the sign of it doesn't change the result at all. And while we're at it, let's take omega M G and replace it by omega M G minus I gamma M over 2. Why do we do that? Because we want to. Look, this denominator could become 0. So if you add an imaginary part, then it doesn't diverge anymore. You can sleep better at night when you know that your equations don't diverge. But what is the physical justification? Well, no spectral line is infinitesimally thick. All spectral lines have a breadth associated with them. The most fundamental reason for line broadening is that the upper level can decay by spontaneous emission, and spontaneous emission then will broaden this upper level and make it acquire some spectral width like this. And if the spectral width is 1 over gamma m, just to get, by standard notation, there's actually a 2 in the numerator here. So it will broaden so that the line width is given by gamma. Gamma in other languages is called the famous 20th century physicist. It's called the Einstein A coefficient, right? Yes, people use gamma when they mean some generalized decay. If it's due to spontaneous emission, it's just equal to the Einstein A coefficient. Okay, so... But now that omega mg is a complex number, if you go back and trace and go through the calculation, you see that you had to take the complex conjugate of this as well. Okay, so... After you do that, then what do you find? You find that P1 is equal to 1 over H bar, sum over P, sum over M, mu GM, mu mg dot E of omega P, omega mg minus omega P, plus mu GM dot E of omega P. P mu m g vector omega m g star plus omega p, and now all of this goes like e to the minus I omega p t. So now both of these terms have the same time dependence. So now it's much easier to look at them and say to yourself that one of them is much more important than the other. And is it obvious that this is the resonant term and this is the anti-resonant term? Because if omega p is nearly equal to this, you'll get a strong resonance, but there's no way that this term here could ever become resonant. And now we have some straightforward bookkeeping issues. So first of all, the linear polarization is just the number density of atoms times the induced dipole moment per atom. We now take P1 of T, express it as the sum of all the frequency components. See, this one has the tilde, this does not. So this is the complex amplitude of the polarization at frequency omega p. And then this quantity here, P1, and let's break it up into Cartesian components now of omega p is equal to epsilon 0 sum over j chi 1 ij of omega p e to the minus I omega p times t, where chi 1 I j at omega p is equal to n over epsilon 0 h bar sum over m, and now two terms, mu g m I mu m g j over omega m g minus omega p plus mu j g m mu I m g omega m g star plus omega p. So a student once said to me, clearly I've seen this derived before, but I've never seen it derived in that complicated a manner. Of course, the Lorentz model of the atom, your very first homework assignment, gave you the same answer. But it's sort of reassuring that quantum mechanics gives you the same functional form. You've learned more now, though. There's a sum over m. In the classical version of the problem, a harmonic oscillator has a single resonance frequency. That is what you mean by harmonic. It has a single resonance frequency. Quantum mechanically, there can be more than one resonance frequency. So that's one thing you learned. And the other thing that you learned is how to calculate the strength of each one of these, because what is mu m g? Well, this is state m mu operator state g, or if you want, this is the integral over all space of psi m star minus ex psi g. Okay, so once you know the wave functions, you can calculate, these are the dipole matrix elements, because you could write this as a matrix. So these are the dipole matrix elements. Once you know the dipole matrix elements, you know the strength of every one of these resonances in the spectrum. So because I've run out of space here, and the university would probably be very unhappy if I continue here, let me call this the resonant and this the anti-resonant. And let's just interpret. By the way, this is very clever, because in Rochester we have a classroom very similar to this, and they put the fire alarm and they put it right here. Well, some people take their jobs very seriously. Okay, so hope the Rochester people are listening. Okay, so the resonant contribution, let me just draw this. The resonant contribution, here is the ground state, here is level m, here is omega p. So if omega p becomes close to this transition frequency, you get a very large enhancement here. But the anti-resonant contribution, well, here is g, and now the arrow is going in the wrong direction, but by assumption, g is the ground state, so there's no way that this could become a resonant contribution. Now, of course, if you have population inversion, then the atom starts out in the upper level, and then this would be the resonant contribution, and this would be the anti-resonant contribution. So, even though you're supposed to sum over all these states, usually one of these terms is dominant. And it is usually this first transition. So the first excited state usually gives you the largest dipole matrix element. Probably for common sense reasons, that if you have a wave function that's distributed way out there, there's not going to be much overlap with one that's in here. But anyway, the first excited state is usually the strongest transition. And then if you plot this, what you find, so we'll plot this as a function of omega p, you find that the imaginary part of chi ij looks like this, and that the real part of chi ij looks like this. And I think you had some, let me do more justice to it, maybe something more like this. And of course, roughly speaking, the real part of the refractive index is proportional to this quantity, and the absorption coefficient is proportional to this quantity here. And we did a lot of things for your homework where you notice that this one actually does not start at zero, whereas this one actually does go to zero. That was the homework, wasn't it? And everybody noted that? And did you note that it makes sense? The susceptibility at zero frequency, that's physical. You put a static electric field across an atom, you're going to pull the electrons one way or the other. As omega goes to infinity, no electron is going to respond at infinite frequency. So at high frequencies, this approaches zero, but at low frequencies, it does not approach zero. And that was one of the things you were supposed to find from the homework. And by the way, and you should know this because you did it numerically, but let me tell you, because it is so easy to do a calculation and then not realize what you ended up calculating. This peak here is exactly half of this peak here. So it's easy to think that textbook writers have this extended sense of aesthetics and they always draw the picture like this to make it look more beautiful. But in fact, the peak to valley swing in the real part of chi is just equal to the peak value of the imaginary part of chi. And that can save your life figuratively in many, many calculations. Like if I ask you, what is the maximum refractive index? What is the maximum refractive index that you can achieve by taking a sodium vapor and heating up the temperature to get the number density very large? That might not seem very easy, but it's usually easier to calculate the absorption. This is the absorption cross section. This is the one that you're more likely to be able to pull out of the air at a moment's notice. What is the maximum absorption here? And then you know that the maximum real part of the susceptibility is just half of that. Or even in the laboratory. You measure the absorption coefficient. You say, I wonder how big the refractive index variation is going to be associated with that. You take your absorption coefficient, 10 per centimeter or 100 per centimeter, turn that into the imaginary part of the susceptibility, you immediately know what the real susceptibility is going to look like, and you know how much refractive index variation there's going to be. Okay, so we can pause at this moment. Are there any questions, any discussion? Yes?
Would you mind telling me about the negative part of refraction index? I cannot understand the meaning of it.
Okay, so, sure. Well, of course, I shouldn't have said equals. I should have said this one is the one you use to calculate this. And of course, the reality is much more complicated because n is the square root of epsilon, which is the square root of 1 plus chi 1. So chi 1 is complex. And because chi 1 is complex, when you take a complex square root, you find that the imaginary part of this depends on both the real and the imaginary parts of that, and vice versa. But this is the intuition that you sort of carry around with you, that the imaginary part of chi is the rate at which you extract energy from the field. And this more directly corresponds to the imaginary part of the refractive index, and the same here. Okay, so that's the first proviso. But I think your question was, can n of omega ever become negative? Well, of course, the only thing I said here is that the susceptibility can become negative. But of course, if this is large enough, then it will drive the entire refractive index negative. And the answer is yes. Okay, next question. Now, I think I understand. You think that this violates something that you had never in your life appreciated the fact that the refractive index can be negative, but it can. I guess how does a wave propagate? E to the I kz minus omega t, and here k is n omega over c. So if n is negative, it means that although the pointing vector is going in this direction, the wave fronts are advancing in this direction. And well, that's not how things work in free space, but this is telling you how things are. And there's nothing wrong with this. I mean, it happens all the time in plasmas. So I'm not sure what more I can say, except we believe in ourselves. We do a calculation. The calculation says that the refractive index can become negative. I guess it can. Say, why would I have ever doubted that? Well, because it's so odd. Of course, the direction of energy flow is not the k vector. The direction of energy flow is the pointing vector. So I think for now we just accept that this is what came out of here. There are homework problems that I sometimes ask, sometimes I don't. One of the ones I love the most is, now that we have this expression for chi 1, I say, let's calculate the refractive index of glass. This is a wonderful final exam problem. Starting with Schrodinger's equation, calculate the refractive index of glass at 500 nanometers. So, and to my amazement, the first time I ever put numbers into this, I got a refractive index of 1.4. So, So, again, n is the square root of epsilon, which is square root of 1 plus chi 1. And chi 1, well, that's not sum over everything. Let's just... I never converted this from Gaussian into SI units. But you can have fun doing it. So chi 1 in Gaussian units is n mu squared over h bar omega 0. And let's take n to be 10 to the 23rd per cubic centimeter. Let's take the dipole moment to be EA naught, which is 2.5 times 10 to the minus 18. Let's take H bar, 1.06 times 10 to the minus 27. Let's take omega 0 to be 10 to the 16th radians per second. And you find that chi 1 is equal to 0.06, but in Gaussian units, this is actually 1 plus 4 pi chi 1. So then 4 pi chi 1 is about equal to 1. And n is then the square root of 2, or about 1.4. So, I guess the only real trick here is that we're assuming that this transition is at omega 0, and that our laser beam is in the visible. So glass, silica, absorbs in the UV. So a typical visible laser might be at half of this frequency. So at that point, if you're doing a very simple calculation, you just set it equal to the resonance frequency here. I guess I didn't tell you my... Okay, are you with me? I did not spoon feed you through this, but I think you probably were following what I was saying. You just put numbers in and you end up very, very happy. Maybe it was worth going to graduate school after all, when you can do things like this and find that the numbers really work themselves out. Now, regrettably, this is a course in nonlinear optics. So this was all linear optics. So we now have to go to higher order in this perturbation expansion. And I will not show you all of the details. It just gets so messy. And in fact, one of the reasons to show you so much detail for chi 1 is so that we were all very, very happy that this all made sense. And now when we do it for chi 2 and chi 3, I will leave out many, many steps. So let's now work out the second order susceptibility. Or chi 2. And we'll go through exactly that same progression. The second order contribution to the dipole moment will be psi 0 mu psi 2 plus psi 1 mu psi 1 plus psi 2 mu psi 0. Right? It has to be second order, and there's three ways that this can happen. First order perturbation on the left and on the right, second order on the right, unperturbed on the left, and the opposite here. So go back to all the equations from the last lecture. Expand this. Let's let omega q go to minus omega q in the second term. That's this one. And let's let omega q go to minus omega q. Omega p goes to minus omega p in the third term. That's this one here. This way, I'll only write down the answer we want, not the intermediate value that we didn't really want. And then we find that the we find an expression for the second order contribution to P. This way I only write down the messy formula once. I'll write down the final result, which is the one we care about. So you get a very complicated expression here. Then you argue that P 2 is equal to N times P 2. You then argue that P 2 can be expressed as the sum over R of P2 omega R e to the minus I omega R T. Now let's write this one out in component form. Well, I guess I really wanted vector symbols everywhere here. And then we can take pi and omega p plus omega 2 and express it as the sum of j and k, the sum of p and 2, chi 2 of ijk omega p plus omega q omega p omega q ej at omega p ek at omega q, where, and of course, this is what we wanted all along, where chi 2 ijk is omega p plus omega q. Omega q, omega p, n over h bar squared, sum over m and n. And now we have three terms, and I'll just write down what they are. U, I, G, N, U, J, N, M, U, K, M, G, omega, N, G, minus omega, P, minus omega, Q, omega mg minus omega p. That's the first term. And the second term, so they're always gn. N, m, mg. But now this one is jik over omega ng squared plus omega q omega m g minus omega p. And the third term is mu g n mu n m mu m g j k I omega n G star plus omega Q omega M G star plus omega P plus omega Q. And now okay, it's exhausting. Not intellectually exhausting because it's so messy. So let's not lose track of the physics though. There are three different sorts of perturbations that can lead to a change in the, that can lead to a second order contribution to the induced dipole moment. This, this, and this. And this is just the bookkeeping here, but in the end, this is what you get. First, how might we interpret this? Well, this first term here is maybe the atom starts in the ground state, then it goes up to level m, then it goes up to level n, and then it comes back to the ground state. So I think this is what we might be inclined to call the totally resonant contribution. Now, this second term here corresponds to a linkage of this sort, omega p. Omega q m and G. So this tells a more intriguing story. You have to ascribe living quantities to atoms for this. So here the atom absorbs a photon and makes a transition to a level that doesn't really exist. It's a virtual level. Now, even more plausibly, the atom emits a photon at frequency omega p plus omega q using energy that it doesn't have. And now anybody who has a bank account knows that you can write a check for more money than you have, but eventually you got to pay it back, and probably sooner rather than later. So the atom says, oh, I made a huge mistake. I emitted more energy than I had a right to, and then it captures this photon here and it comes back to the ground state. And then the last term here is the totally anti-resonant term, where here the atom absorbs one photon and then the other photon. So this might be omega p, this might be omega q, this is g, this is n, and this is m. So I told you the story in the most provocative way I could so that you don't fall asleep on me. Right? You don't learn anything if the classroom is sound asleep. The other reason I told it in such a provocative manner is that you say, well, that seems so implausible. What atom would possibly do this? Well, in a sense, that's the whole point. This one is usually a far, far more dominant process than this one here. Well, especially when you're tuned to resonance, but even when you're detuned from resonance, this is closer to being resonant than either of these. Now, there's a couple of bookkeeping issues that we need to deal with. You look at this equation. Is this an acceptable expression for a second-order susceptibility? Think back to the second lecture of the semester. We said that as a friendly convention, we would make sure that our susceptibility always obeys intrinsic permutation symmetry, and this doesn't. So really, really you should put a 1/2 here, and you write equations here where omega p and omega q are interchanged. Okay, so if you want this to display intrinsic permutation symmetry, instead of writing down three terms, you really have to write all six terms, where there is essentially no information content to these, because omega p and omega q were dummy. P and q were dummy indices anyway. So what many people do, including myself, is you introduce, I call this the intrinsic permutation operator. It says, pretend that you've written this down twice with omega p and omega q interchanged here. Now, there's still another bookkeeping issue to be dealt with. Am I up to explaining this to you? Let's consider far off resonance excitation. Well, these are always far off resonance, this one and this one. But this one here, we'll assume that the lowest level excited state is very high in energy, so that you have no possibility of omega p or of omega p plus omega q resonantly exciting any state of the atom. In this case, you can ignore the distinction between omega and g and its complex conjugate. The real part so overwhelms the imaginary part that it hardly matters whether you do or do not add the imaginary part. Uh, under these circumstances, you can actually combine all three of these into a single equation. And you sometimes see this single equation written in textbooks. If nothing else, it makes nonlinear optics seem much less obnoxious because it's actually a rather compact expression that you end up with. Omega sigma, omega q, omega p. Sigma stands for sum. This is just the mnemonic. That sometimes I will write omega sigma here, meaning that's the sum of this one and this one. And this is equal to n. I think this is from an earlier edition of the book because there's no epsilon zero here. But we all know that really epsilon zero is equal to one. Okay, so it's in SI units in the book. The issues we are dealing with in lecture today, you don't care whether there's an epsilon zero or not. You can write this as m over h bar squared. This I'll call the full permutation operator. Sum over m and n, mu g n, mu n m, mu m g, I j k. Omega n g minus omega sigma. Omega mg minus omega p. So it's just the first term here, but the full permutation means sum over all of omega sigma, omega p, omega q, omega sigma, omega q, omega p. Minus omega p, minus omega sigma, minus omega q, minus omega q, minus omega q minus omega sigma. Okay. Take all the orders in which you could put omega p, omega q, and omega sigma, add them all together. You then get back to your six terms that you had here, but you have all six terms written as just a single expression. And you just formally rearrange the omega sigma, the omega p, and the omega q in this expression. So, what have we shown? I promised you, I delivered. In one of the early lectures, I promised that we would show that under lossless circumstances, chi 2 obeys full permutation symmetry. Okay, so let's pause here and see if there's any discussion on any of this. It's actually written down in the book. I was trying to do this by pure thought. And I think I got it pretty much right, actually. But the six permutations are written right out in the book, right after equation 3.2.28. You know what's coming next. 1, 2, chi 3. Actually, let's not... I mean, it's more of the same. Do a very, very rapid we will do even less of chi 3 than we did for chi 2. Actually, let me pause before we erase any discussion on any of this.
Can we ask something from the previous sessions?
I'm sorry, repeat that, please.
Can we ask something from previous sessions?
Sure, of course.
I want to find out about the interaction time between the laser pulse and when it goes to the material, the nonlinear response. Because I know, is it completely instantaneous or no? Takes time, even short time.
Okay. Good questions are not always easy questions. Huh? So I'll do this in red because it's an aside. Okay, you have a short pulse of light falling onto some optical material. I'll just write the linear response here. We can generalize that if we want to. Oh, what happens? Well, there's going to be some response time. And maybe we're just as well to go back to the classical model of the harmonic oscillator. And that had some damping parameter gamma, which is 1 over some sort of response time. So I think it's easiest to think in terms of a step function. So the electric field is initially 0, and then at time t equals 0, it turns itself on. And you might ask, what is even the linear response to something like this? And what you'll find is that it will approach steady state. And some characteristic time, this is time, some characteristic time will be this t, 1 over gamma. So it takes time for the effect to turn itself on and turn itself off. So that line of reasoning tells you that if E of t is a very short pulse. Let's not do a delta function because that's too easy. So what happens then is that p of t versus t, it starts to turn on, but then the pulse goes away. So on the same scale as before, I mean, if it had turned on and stayed on, it would have done this. But it's only partly reached its steady state value before the pulse turns itself off again. So I think that is the simplest, you know, that is one limit. If you look at it from a nonlinear optics, this was the linear response. You know, you can, you have a bell and you bang the bell and the bell keeps ringing. So some physical systems will keep ringing after the pulse turns off, some don't. This is called adiabatic following. And the key issue is whether collisions happen while the pulse is on or not. If you have a totally conservative system, the system will just turn itself off coherently. If you have lots of collisions while the pulse is on, then you've lost coherence. There's no mechanism for the polarization to decay away. And then I think what you have, I'll blow this up now, is that you have a rapid turn on and small decay. We are trusting my memory for something I have not studied for 10 years. Okay. You know, there are two time constants, T1 and T2. So if you transfer population to the upper level, it'll stick around for a time T1. But the there's a different response time for going up and for coming down. And the cheap way out is to say, oh, but Professor Lundeen teaches that course, not me. I'm not supposed to know the answer to this. But that's not fair, because I think if you look at the chapter on the two-level atom, I do have some things about this in the adiabatic following limit. But I did not come to class prepared to give a cogent answer to what's really a complicated question. But I think the right answer is along the lines of what I just said to you. Okay, let's do chi 3. Three, and now we once again start off asking what is the third order contribution to the induced dipole moment per atom. So we'll have psi 0, mu psi 3 plus psi 1 mu psi 2 plus psi 2 mu psi 2 plus psi 3 mu psi 0. So there's going to be four contributions. But then, in the end, what we are going to want is chi 3 of omega sigma omega r omega q, omega p. So there are six permutations. So there's going to be 6 times 4 equals 24 terms. Of course, only 4 of them display different physical resonances. The others are just from a renaming of the input field frequencies. I will show you only one of the 4 terms. You can look up the rest in the book. I will show you the resonant one because our intuition usually comes from that. So it's n over h bar cubed pi sum over m n nu. Now in the numerator, mu g nu, mu nu n, mu n m, mu m g. And we're not doing Cartesian, so we won't put the indices on. Omega nu g minus omega r minus omega q minus omega p, omega n g minus omega q minus omega p, and omega m g minus omega p. Let's look at what the resonance structure here looks like. So, 2, 3. So we have G, M, N, nu, and as written, omega P, omega Q, and omega R. But let's look at the formal structure of this. This was true also for chi 1 and chi 2, but it's more evident at chi 3. You have a 1 photon resonance. You have a 2 photon resonance. And you have a 3 photon resonance. You have H bar occurring to third order, because each order of perturbation theory, just track your way back to the interaction Hamiltonian, each order of perturbation theory pulled down another factor of H bar. Quantum mechanics reads better right to left than left to right. So you start in the ground state, you go to level M. From level M, you go to level N. From level N, you go to level nu. From level nu, you go back to G. So this and this has to be the same, because that's how the story works itself out. You go from G to M, so this one had better take you from M to N, and this one had better take you from N to nu, and this one then back. And if you just look at this picture, you can see that from just looking at the picture. So make sure that this... Now what are the other terms? Yeah, what are the other terms? So the ones that we didn't show explicitly, well, you can go this, 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 and this, where you have G, M, N, nu. Or you can go this, this, G M M nu, and then the totally anti-resonant term 1, 2, 3. Now, I think that one could almost imagine a midterm examination in which I ask you to write down from memory the expression for chi3. I mean, how could you not get the right answer? You draw this picture, and then once you draw that picture, what could you possibly have forgotten? Well, h bar cubed. Scales like the number density of atoms. Mu gm, mu mn, mu m nu, mu nu g. So I mean, everything just falls out. Everything just falls out. For just, you draw that picture, there's only four ways of drawing the picture. But regrettably, I think I told you you could bring a page of equations into the midterm exam. So now that guarantees that everyone will have this written down on your one page of equations, but you might not really make use of it. Okay, it's time to take a break, right? So let's break for about 10 minutes or so. So this is the way to make students happy. I will let you decide when you want the midterm exam.
Do you want next week?
Can
we not decide?
So that, I think somebody said we've not decided?
Yeah.
Did we?
We said it's after the reading week.
Yeah, we said
it. Oh, when is reading week?
Yeah. That's a good
week. The week of the 24th.
Yeah, 24th.
So we decided, what did we decide? But this is reading week?
Yeah, reading week.
So it'll be the 31st then?
Sure.
Yes?
Halloween, yeah. What else can be scary?
So the midterm exam will be October 31st, right?
Okay. Is this whole table?
Or last
Oh, so there's a class next week. No, there's a class next week.
No, I mean, is it take home or no?
I'm getting overloaded. Let me write this down. Last time we had this discussion, I didn't write it down. So midterm. Ottawa. It will be in class. It's much better for you. The pain doesn't last as long. If it's a take-home exam, the pain lasts 24 hours. If it's in class, the pain lasts 2 hours. I guess for the midterm exam, we should have a 2-hour exam. And you can stay 3. But I mean, I will write it for 2 hours. Some people like to not be rushed. No, if you give a 2-hour exam, if you write a 2-hour exam and tell people they can take 3 hours, they'll leave after 2. But if you tell them they only have 2 hours, they get nervous because they think they're rushed for time, and they develop strategic postures that are maybe not the very best. Say, well, I have to maximize the number of points on this with the constraint, like Lagrange multipliers. You have a constraint that says I cannot work for more than 17 and a half minutes on this problem here. So, I think I already promised I will send out past midterm exams so that everybody gets a good idea of what might be asked. I usually have at least one question from a previous year's exam that encourages you to encourages you to study in a more directed fashion. I'm sorry, question.
Will we be able to bring in like a cheat sheet?
Yeah, one page.
One page?
Double-sided.
Okay.
One page, double-sided. And I should write a message to everybody to document this. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Two questions. First, up to which lectures?
I don't know.
You don't know. Mm-hmm. All right. Second question. Mm-hmm. Will we have feedback on the assignments we're giving back to Frederick? It's the third over.
How many has he returned so far?
Zero. It's the third. We just gave back the third another.
Okay. So he needs a reminder from me, right? In fact, last week I said I would remind him, right? And I didn't.
Possible also to get the solutions for
this?
Yes!
No, sorry.
Enough said. He needs a very polite reminder. Okay, any more discussion before we begin?
So no filming on the 24th and
Right. First. Yeah. You're right. Yeah. So no filming. Oh, wouldn't that be awful to have the camera here? You're taking your exam and he's
That's fine as long as we
yeah. So 24th, the entire there are no classes at all that week. There are no classes at all that entire week. You told me that. It didn't get onto my calendar. So this time I wrote it down. So I have a paper calendar. No, I have a paper notebook. And eventually this gets transferred to my electronic calendar, which gets stored on iCloud. So even if my computer gets lost, its content will not get lost. Okay, any more discussion?
Yeah, about the assignment. Can you give your assignment tomorrow after tomorrow?
Say that again?
The assignment.
Because I need to give you an assignment?
We can give you the assignment tomorrow after tomorrow.
Oh, of course. Oh, can you turn it in late?
Yeah.
No, I thought you were reminding me. Professor, you've not given us enough work. Would you please... Would you please remember to give us more work? yes, so people can take 2 more days. Somebody found a mistake in the book. Who was it?
Well, I don't know.
I thought it was you. A likely mistake in the book.
Yes.
Yeah, sometimes I think. No, I ask a couple other people to help me look into it. I'm sure you're right. I cannot imagine that there was a mistake that has been going on for years and years and years in the book Cramer's Kronig relations. When you integrate from minus infinity to infinity, there's no doubt about it. When you integrate from zero to infinity, you have to rearrange them a little bit. And Jefferson points out that it sure looks like there's a mistake. And I ask two people please just look into this with me. I think it's wrong, but I want someone else to confirm this before I tell the world that there's a mistake there. And was this part of the homework? It was, yeah. And you need it for the homework. And it's the homework due today? Okay.
Yes.
So how many of you got the right answer to the homework? You weren't supposed to, right? Jefferson's position is that if you take the question literally as written, you will not get the right answer, because I ask you to look at the book and use an equation from the book, and the equation of the book seems to be wrong. I suppose you'd like me to document this? No.
So we should look up the Cramer-Kronig relation somewhere else, or?
No, keep asking me. Why don't you tell, do you remember, do you have your email in front of you?
Yes.
Why don't you tell them? Wait, who has the book? So why don't you just take that equation and write it correctly? Or even I can do it then.
I think it's 58.
I remember. No. Oh, page 58. Ah, but you didn't open it to 58. 58. And now it's important to write it carefully, because that was the whole point. 2 omega over pi 0 to infinity. No. Imaginary part of chi 1 omega prime d omega prime over omega prime squared minus omega squared. No, that was your conjecture, right? Clearly, it's profound laziness on my part. It would take 3 minutes to check this. It's either right or it's wrong. It's either right or it's wrong, and it's probably wrong. Okay, so. The book has an omega prime inside the expression. We now believe that it's omega on the outside of the expression.
I was pretty sure the book was right, having it inside.
Ah! The two of you can...
Well, what I've done was to compare that result with the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity, and they disagree. So I just check
that expression.
And then when you replaced it with yours, it worked.
Yes.
Okay, so I used this one and it gave me the right answer on the homework.
How do you know it is the right answer?
Because there's a table of Hilbert transforms and I looked it up.
Did you compare with the last version of that expression from infinity to plus infinity? I mean, this question.
Oh, that the for when I use this one, that other form didn't work, so I don't know what it was. But this, I don't remember the derivation, but I thought that it was you multiply inside the integral by the...
Why don't the two of you, I mean, I'll stop lecture early. This is enormous laziness on my part. It can't take more than 3 minutes, right, to just work it out and see what we get. So the two of you, why don't you stay, and the three of us will do it together. Boy, am I glad I put the question there. Okay, we're not sure. An issue has been raised that maybe there's a mistake in the book. Plausibility says that the book is right, because I've had mathematicians write to me about subtle convergence issues. Say, yeah, he didn't say that exactly right, this argument. Of course, mathematicians would be far more likely to catch a convergence issue than the wrong answer, because that's not what they're looking for. Okay. So, let me, to motivate the next discussion, this is what's called the linear polarizability. Linear polarizability. If P is equal to that, common sense might make you think that if you know the linear polarizability described in this manner here, that the susceptibility is just n times larger. You would think so, right? But has anybody ever told you that this is not true? Now, I'm going to do the whole thing more carefully, but this is to at least get your attention, that this is something worth thinking about. It's the distinction between microscopic and macroscopic quantities in optical physics. You've probably maybe heard this at some point in your lives, that there's the microscopic Maxwell equations and the macroscopic Maxwell equations. And for example, if E is the microscopic field, the for lack of better, the one we know and love, we call the Maxwell field. Or the macroscopic field. This is a volume average of the microscopic field. So why don't we always use the microscopic field? I mean, this is certainly a sort of approximation. Well, let's just look at an atom. Here's the nucleus, and here is the electron going around it. So if we were to plot the electric field strength as a function of position, and let's say the so as you get close to the nucleus, there's a huge contribution to the local electric field. But this is of no interest in optics because the wavelength of light is huge on that scale. So it would be bad enough conceptually, but can you imagine doing it numerically, solving Maxwell's equations numerically? You'd have to have a grid size of a hundredth of a nanometer. And even a multi-core processor could not deal with problems of that complexity. So you cannot just argue this problem away. From a practical point of view, you need to distinguish between the microscopic field and the macroscopic field. So alpha is a microscopic quantity, but this is a macroscopic quantity. And the question is, how do you relate the two of them to one another? How many of you have heard of the Lorentz law? Well, then you know why it was Lorentz said no. And how many of you have heard of the Clausius-Massotti relation? And how many of you know it's the same thing? You do not. What do you do now? So Clausius and Massotti were chemists and they were thinking of low-frequency fields. Lorentz and Lorenz were thinking optical frequency fields. It's basically the same law. And some people think that Lorentz and Lorenz should not get as much credit as they got. But the two groups came at this so differently. The intellectual framework was so different that even though they're formally the same, I think it's useful to call this the Lorentz law. Remarkably, they're two different men with almost the same last name, and they made the same discovery within a year of each other. And I guess Canadians would know this. I just found out recently, the St. Lawrence River, it's the same name. Lorentz is German, or Lorenz without the T was Danish. Lorentz with the T was Dutch. And Lorenzo, it's all the same name. Europeans would know things like that, right? Because you have neighbors. Americans, all we have is Canada. And when examined carefully, Canadians are just as stupid as Americans are. So it really doesn't help. Not us. We're talking about the people on the street. Okay, so Emma Wolf is my colleague at Rochester. The stories are more fun than the physics. Emma Wolf is my colleague at Rochester, and he publishes this anthology called Progress in Optics. And he got a paper on the Lorentz law from a very famous Danish scientist who very carefully called it the Lorentz law. Emil Wolf's secretary went through his manuscript, changed it to Lorentz, and wrote to him and said, "I hope you like the change I made. I hope you like the change I made because it is my understanding that it's called the Lorentz law." Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that a wonderful story? That's what happens when you try to rewrite history. He says, "Well, just clearly a mistake." Okay, so let's do this for linear optics. Of course, we want to see how to generalize it for nonlinear optics, but we'll start with linear optics. Lorentz made a key assumption that's different from what I had written on the board just a minute ago. He said that mu is epsilon 0 alpha. So this is the induced dipole. He introduced something called E local. It's the field that the molecule fields. So what is the field that a molecule feels? We often call this the Lorentz field. It's the field from external sources. And all other at molecules in the sample. So, which I guess makes sense. That in any macroscopic sample, you have one test molecule here, and you have a laser field, say, coming in, but then each atom in the sample develops a dipole moment, and this dipole moment generates a dipole field. So this atom sitting here feels the field of the input laser beam plus the field of every other atom in the sample. And once you can say, oh, we just do it numerically. Well, you don't really want to sum over 10 to the 23rd other contributions. So so you have to try to figure out some clever way to exclude this one atom here. You want the field of everything except for the one atom under consideration. So Lorentz's prescription is that E local is the field at the center of a spherical cavity in the material. You form the spherical cavity in a very special way. You don't allow the other molecules to relax. You just conceptually scoop out a certain volume, but assume that all the other molecules maintain the same dipole moment they would have had otherwise. So here is what Lorentz said. So inside the material, you have, we know about Fresnel coefficients. So knowing the field outside, you can calculate the field inside. This field inside will create a polarization. But then here is your test molecule, and the local field is the field at the very center of this molecule. And this is a standard homework problem in electrostatics for a sphere, or any ellipsoid for that matter. The polarization is uniform. Well, here the polarization is zero, but you just replace it by the inverse problem. And what you find is that E local is equal to E plus 1 over 3 epsilon 0 times P. So remind you that D is epsilon 0 times E. Well, let's set epsilon equal to 1. Lorentz was certainly smart enough to set epsilon 0 equal to 1. Let's us do the same thing. So you see E local is... D is equal to epsilon 0 E plus P. So Lorentz says, well, the local field, it's not quite E, but it's not quite D either. It's sort of partway between D and E. It's as if when God was inventing electromagnetic theory, he couldn't decide whether it should be D or E. He could find good arguments one way or the other. He said, let's put it partway between the two. We'll sort of symmetrize it between D and E. Okay, so, but this is what you get. If you work out this problem as a problem in electrostatics, calculate the field at this point here in an evacuated spherical volume inside a uniformly polarized material, this is what you get. You probably worked it out the other way, a uniformly polarized sphere, but then by superposition. You can just calculate. Take a uniformly polarized sphere, calculate the field at the center of it, and then change the sign of this, add it to the, and then you get this result here. And you've seen that before, huh? You did. You've maybe forgotten, but I cannot believe that anybody let you get to graduate school in physics or in electrical engineering without having worked out this problem. Okay, so, but why would Lorentz say something? Okay, God decreed it. but why did Lorentz think that this was even a rational thing to do? So here's how he argued. Here is your test particle, and here are its six nearest neighbors. One outside the board, one in front of the board, one behind the board. If you calculate the field at this point here, due to the six nearest neighbors, they sum to zero. Field of a dipole looks like this. So up here it's pointing this way, here it's pointing that way. And there's that famous factor of two that you always forget which term has a two in it. The six nearest neighbors add to zero. So conceptually, you remove them. Now there are six other atoms that are the nearest neighbors out here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They sum to zero. You remove them. So the only thing that's left over is the field from everything else as modified by this spherical boundary. So Lorentz's prescription is that for the nearby ones, you'll do a discrete summation. The ones that are far away, you'll use a continuum approximation. So that gives you this result here. Okay, now it's just five lines of algebra. I mean, the tricky conceptual point is understanding what would have made Lorentz think that that this is what it would be. So now, let's be very careful. We still have that P is equal to N times mu, which is N epsilon 0 alpha E local, which is N epsilon 0 alpha E plus 1 over 3 epsilon 0 times P. So there's a P on the left-hand side, the P on the right-hand side. You pull them both over to the same side of the equation, and you find that P is equal to epsilon 0 times N alpha over 1 minus 1/3 N alpha. And by definition, this is chi 1 E. So chi 1 is epsilon 0 goes there. So chi 1 is N alpha times 1 minus 1/3 N alpha. So it's not what you might have thought. It's actually bigger than what you might have thought. Now, what is a third and alpha? Question.
I think there's an E missing in your in the middle of your second to last.
Thank
question.
You. Yeah. Thank you. Here. So, what is this product here? It's of the order of unity, right? Is that obvious to everyone? Now, I'm supposed to say, as is obvious, this is of the order of unity. Here's a molecule for condensed matter. So the, let's say you have molecules there of volume V. So the number density is going to be approximately equal to 1 over the volume. But now, what is the polarizability of any spherical body? It's the volume. Did you know that? You do now. Now, for a dielectric sphere, it's the volume of the sphere times epsilon. I forgive. It's of the order of the volume of the sphere. And there's a correction depending on the dielectric constant of the inside and the dielectric constant outside. And it's somewhere in the book. You can look it up if you want to know exactly what it is. But this is the intuition you can carry around with you. That's why you can do calculations on the back of an envelope. Polarizability of anything is of the order of magnitude of the volume. For the non-resonant response of an atom, take the cube of the Bohr radius. For the resonant response of an atom, take the cube of the wavelength. Because under resonant conditions, an atom acts as if it has a size equal to the wavelength of its resonance radiation. Okay, so okay, so this is, but there's a third there. So usually you don't have a zero in the denominator. But sometimes you do have a zero in the denominator. And this is a way to understand the presence of, understand ferroelectrics, materials with a permanent electric dipole moment. So in a ferroelectric, it's not that P is infinite, It's that E is zero. Even though you apply zero electric field, you can have a macroscopic polarization inside the material because there's a zero in the denominator because of this effect here. Okay, so this is the Lorentz-Lorentz law. Now, it can be rewritten in another way that provides a different insight. If I now define epsilon 1 equal to 1 plus chi 1 and introduce this into this equation here and rearrange it, you find that epsilon 1 minus 1 over epsilon 1 plus 2 is 1 third m alpha. And they are both called Lorentz-Lorentz law because they are they display the same physics, just expressed differently. And just taking the equations on the board, we can write that this chi 1 is epsilon 1 plus 2 over 3 times n alpha, or you can write that E local is epsilon 1 plus 2 over 3 times E. This is almost unprecedented in physics, that the correction, that after you put in the correction, the effect gets bigger, not smaller. That the local field, the Lorentz field, is bigger than the Maxwell field. Now, you say to yourself, what's the name of this course? Nonlinear optics. Hey, if the local field is bigger than the macroscopic field, this is going to tend to enhance nonlinear optical interactions. So this epsilon plus 2 over 3 is called the local field correction factor. And as Saad knows, Professor Dogoleva and I love local field corrections. I mean, she and I have written a number of papers together on this, and you can see why. It's just so beautiful the way these things just mesh together so beautifully. So let's now look at local field effects in nonlinear optics. Let's pick up on that thought. You can treat local field effects generally, but let's work out one example that I think is really shows you, gives you the insight as to what is going on. So we'll consider the susceptibility that leads to the M2 type of nonlinear response, omega plus omega minus omega. If I didn't say this before, be careful what order you write them in, at least when you're talking about the Cartesian subscripts. Which one you call the minus omega is important. So if somebody disagrees with your tensor form of chi 3, the first thing you have to do is check what the frequency arguments are. Okay, so so we want an expression for chi 3 that's correct to third order. And maybe I should even say self-consistent. So let's start by saying that P of omega is epsilon 0 times n times alpha of omega e local plus 3 epsilon 0 n. I'll just call it gamma 3. I'm not sure I've used this semester. Chi 3 per molecule. We need a name for it, and gamma 3 sounds as good as anything. Times E local squared E local. Now, on the second term, we can just take E local to be epsilon 1 plus 2 over 3 times E, the result that we had here. But on the left-hand side of the equation, we have to be more careful, because here we have to use the more precise form that E local is equal to P plus 1 over 3 epsilon 0 times P. Now, this plays havoc with your semantics. The linear term depends on E local, but E local has a nonlinear contribution. So there's actually a contribution to chi 3 from this term here, because P itself has a nonlinear contribution. So now it's the same thing as before. You take the P, write this all out, bring the P over to the other side of the equation, solve for P, and you find that P of omega is equal to epsilon 0 chi 1 of omega E of omega. Well, this is just the definition now. And then I'll write down the expression. So, as before, by definition, this is 3 epsilon 0 chi 3 of omega equals omega plus omega minus omega E of omega squared E of omega. Okay, so you do this up. Yes.
What is the argument that say that we can use the formula we found for nonlinear term, but for the linear term we have to take the polarization?
Okay. This is explicitly third order already. So any correction from this would be higher than third order. Okay. Where chi 1 is the same as we had before, n alpha of omega 1 minus 1 third n alpha. But we find that chi 3 of omega equals omega plus omega minus omega is equal to epsilon plus 2 over 3 squared epsilon plus 2 over 3 absolute modulus squared times n gamma 3 omega equals omega plus omega minus omega. So we find that chi 3 is enhanced by this product here. Let's see how big it is. So epsilon plus 2 over 3. Epsilon is n squared. If n is 2, this would be 4. So this is 4 plus 2 over 3, which is equal to 2. So you say it's an enhancement by a factor of 2, which does not seem very much until you raise it to the fourth power and you find that nonlinear effects are 16 times stronger than you might have thought otherwise. So we have to choose our words carefully. This is not magic. We have not enhanced the nonlinear response. It's just that it is 16 times larger than you might have expected in terms of naive reasoning. But this then starts you thinking that maybe I could well, of course, we were thinking of homogeneous materials here. And then you might say, well, what about inhomogeneous materials? It is how you spell it in Canada? In the UK, it's different. They say inhomogeneous. This is spelled correctly, yes? If Canada and the US agrees, we know it's right. Mm-hmm. Let me start off with a randomly inhomogeneous material. And let's say that it's made up of cells. This cell has dielectric constant epsilon 1. This cell has dielectric constant epsilon 2. Now, what's going to happen, you apply a laser field to this material, and the field will be different in the two materials. It will be smaller than average in some and larger than average in others. And this is good. And the reason is, well, let's just say that you put a small modulation on this. So here is E, and now once you go to E cubed, you find that the peaks are enhanced more than the valleys are shrunk. So you find that E cubed average is greater than E averaged cubed. So So this first effect was not real in a certain sense. It was just there. It's just that you'd overlooked it before. But if you intentionally design a material to be inhomogeneous, then the electric field becomes inhomogeneous, and that tends to enhance nonlinear optical effects. And this is for real. My students and I have done a number of experiments to demonstrate this effect. Okay, so it is... Okay, so I mean, I think the formal part of the lecture wants to end now. And we can have questions and discussion insofar as you would like. So, class is over. Now it's time for recitation. Yes.
So how can we read type 2?
For what?
For this.
Well, I think what I said is that I can't do everything, so I'll do this one here because the result seems more compelling. We had 4 local field factors. For chi 2, you have only 3. By the way, 4, not 3. It's when you pull this over to the other side that you pick up another factor. So people who try to conceptualize this say, well, the 3 input fields are all enhanced, but then the material couples more strongly to the output field as well. And this almost justifies this sort of notation, that there really are 4 frequencies involved here. If they were all different, you would see it. If it was omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, and omega sigma, you'd have a local field for each of the different frequencies, including omega sigma. At this sort of microscopic level, the polarization an oscillating dipole moment radiates, but it becomes a more effective radiator because of local field corrections. Well, so, of course, since I like local field enhancement of nonlinear optics, I choose to work with chi 3 and not with chi 2, so I pick up another factor of 2. So, good question. Yes?
I just wanted to ask at the bottom of the board there, when you wrote epsilon was 2 over 3, why did you say epsilon was 4? Is that supposed
to be? Well, because N typical max equals 2.
Oh.
So, I mean, you can think of perverse examples where it's bigger, but I didn't want to cheat too badly. So I said, I'm thinking of a material in which the refractive index is 2.
Okay.
So that's all I meant.
I thought you might have been...
No, I wasn't. I meant a typical value of epsilon plus 2 over 3 might be 2. And that was the sense in which I meant that. So what did we So did Mona come in?
Yeah.
And I forget if I asked you already. Are you receiving email messages from me?
I received 2 messages.
You did receive it?
Yeah.
Good, good, good. And did May receive it? Yeah. How would we know? She's not here. But I know that, but I took her name from the CERC website. So I'm pretty sure that...
The lecture.
Okay, good. Okay, and then we still have to worry about the person from Manitoba, was it? Yeah. But I have his email. Now that you remind me who he is, I know I have his email address. Because Albert Stolo, Albert Stolo is jointly advising him, right?
Yeah.
So all I have to do is search my email account for Stolo, Manitoba, and this student's email address will pop out. Okay. Any other topics? Any questions? Yes.
How come we never consider higher order chi?
Okay. Come back next week.
Okay.
No. So, well, we did, didn't we? We did harmonic generation with focused laser beams. Chi 5, chi 7, not HHG in the sense of Paul Corkum, but we talked about how to what optimum focusing would be for chi 5 for fifth harmonic generation, seventh harmonic generation. So we talked about it a little bit. If you want to, it's because it's not every day of the week that you want to do seventh harmonic generation. Okay, that's one answer. Second, if you want the second order correction factor to chi 3, you might begin wondering if you should even be using a power series expansion to begin with. So maybe you should use the methods of resonance nonlinear optics and treat it as a Rabi oscillation problem or as a saturation phenomenon. And there's a whole chapter on nonlinear optics of the two-level atom. So So if you have a multi-level atom, you can write chi 3 exactly. Well, chi 3 is an approximation. You can find an analytic expression for chi 3, but only for chi 3. For a two-level atom in the presence of a near-resonant laser field, you restrict yourself to two energy levels, but you can find a non-perturbative solution. Which, in a sense, everyone in the room knows already, because the standard expression for a saturable absorber. So one limit to this problem is just that alpha is equal to alpha 0 over 1 plus I over Is. Where now alpha is the absorption coefficient, not the linear polarizability. Okay, so I mean, this you knew already, but this is one limiting form of the non-perturbative solution of a two-level atom in the presence of a resonance driving field. So there's a trade-off. If you only treat two levels, then suddenly you can go further in terms of getting an analytic expression for the response. I think we're done, except for three of us who need to calculate. You need a small calculation now? Okay, so class is over. But of course, everybody is willing to come and help us derive that expression. You probably want your microphone better.